Acha, the question is, there's a butterfly on the screen, which I am not going to discuss because it's a very destructive butterfly found in Western Ghats. And it is, what is the new name given to it?
What has happened?
One second. Okay, Clues for Blues was presented initially by me in a workshop held at Pashmadi during the Satpura butterfly survey. I have modified those slides a bit, not much, but still main components of the slides are same. A few of you might have witnessed these slides, but still it will be good for us to again go ahead and learn those beautiful blues and how to identify them. Acha, the question is, there's a butterfly on the screen, which I am not going to discuss because it's a very destructive butterfly found in Western Ghats. And it is, what is the new name given to it? Can you tell me that common name? It was earlier called as Indian Cupid. What is the new name? Rohit sir?
No sir, no idea.
What is the new?
I know it as Indian Cupid only. Dakkan Cupid.
Dakkan Cupid is the new name, yeah. It is called now Dakkan Cupid in the Indian Foundation of Butterflies website. But we call it by the Indian Cupid, and it has got a distinctive red crown on the black spot in the tail, near the tail, hind wing. Can you see it? Yeah. One second. Why it is shifting? Okay. Here, my God, it's so sensitive. I have to learn how to use it. Aiyoh. Chalo, let me. I'll go ahead. Now this is the first screen. I'll go to second screen. How to identify butterflies is a question. Butterflies are the insects which can mostly be easily identified by its looks and colors. So the basic indicators for a butterfly are the size of the butterfly, the basic geometry of the wings, the base color of the butterfly, the flight patterns, perching postures. They give you an idea of a butterfly. Okay, what it could be. May not to the species level, but of course, sometimes to the family level or to the genus level, of course. And there are specialized indicators like what are spots on the wings, the ocelles, the veins, the colors of the eyes. And of course, if you are unable to distinguish a butterfly, especially the darts and various skippers like the Caltoris species and a few more species for which there are no distinctive features which can distinguish two similar species, for them we have to do a laboratory procedure that includes dissection of the butterfly, male butterfly genitalia, and followed by DNA sequencing. So those things are specialized things. A citizen scientist need not bother about that. We can, of course, take the help of scientists and people like Krishna Mekunte and his laboratory to get those species butterfly identified. The problem is we are not having any scope for catching a butterfly and sending it to him. We are not allowed to do that. So we'll keep that aside and try to learn about butterflies which are around us and which are easily can be identified with their features. Okay, I'll go to the first screen. Now it's very important for us to know the various parts of the wings. For a newcomer, we must have this particular screen with us in a printed form for some time, maybe 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, so that you can learn about the various parts of the wings and the various vegetation. The vegetations, there are veins in the wings which adds to the key pointers which can distinguish between two similar species. Okay, every butterfly wing has some number of veins and a cell, and you can easily see that the cell has been blue colored on the top left figure, and cell is a place which signifies the central part of the wing or almost central part. Beyond cell, there are veins originating from cell, and vein number one, it never originates from the cell. It originates from the base of the wing. Can you see the vein number one, which is originating from the base of the screen of the wing? So that is one thing, and there are other areas of the wing which are to be understood mainly for a newcomer. Those areas are the various parts of the costa, the apex, the turmen, the tornus, the dorsum, and the base. So these are the various, the edge of the wing is called the margin. And of course, there are areas in the wing which are called the base of the wing, the post-basal area, the discal area, the post-discal area, and the apical area. Okay, apical and the sub-apical areas. So various spots are basically oriented and, are kept confined to these zones. And as a butterfly enthusiast and a person who wants to learn about butterflies, must be able to decipher a screen by matching this particular diagram with a live butterfly's photograph. Then you will be able to understand where those spots are, because I may be in between saying that, it's an apical spot, or maybe I'll be taking a post discal band or a discal band, or lunules and ocelles. Those things are part of the butterfly. Even cilia is the white hairy structure which are the part of the wing. So this is a base figure which will be always helpful for us to understand and perceive a butterfly in greater details. So I'll skip this. Anything else?
Yeah, just one point. Can you move your cursor a bit? That toolbar is coming right on the screen.
Toolbar? I can't see any toolbar.
Okay, cool. Maybe mine then.
It's your. I cannot. Anybody having any problem in seeing this video?
No, it's not.
This particular screen, it's very clear.
No,
no. Okay.
No, if you move your mouse out, then you
have toolbar. Not at all.
Okay. Now I'll go to the next screen, which actually will be discussing about real butterflies. Okay, the first screen is having a very two common species found in Bangalore. One to my left is the red flash, and to my right is the slate flash. So these two butterflies are very similar. As you can see from the screen, that in your slate flash, the band at the top of the we try to figure out why, whether it's a straight flash or red flash, by looking at the various bands. Sometimes even looking at the bands will also not help, because they are very similar, especially females. The only thing which distinguishes a female and a male by looks is the amount of the point of the forewing, how pointed the forewing is. For a female, it is female slate flash, it is not that pointed, whereas a female red flash is quite more convincingly pointed. As you see in the figures of the red flash and slate flash, I'll try to use. Okay, 1 minute. Okay, it is shifting. I don't know why it is shifting. Can you see this? Okay, why it is shifting here? There's a problem with this. I don't know why. Oh my God. Okay, I will not use it. I'm not very much habitual in using this. Let me try to show you the pointer. Can you see the pointer here? Yeah. So this is a female red flash and this is a male red flash. See, both look very similar. The female and the male red flash look very similar. The only distinguish between a female red flash and the male red flash is the amount of red available. And the amount of red, the female red flash is paler than the male red flash, but both are red, which is sometimes very confusing to find in the field whether it is a female red flash or a male red flash. And even the experts also get confused to see whether we have photographed or see the male red flash or a female red flash. If you get the underwing shot, then you'll be easily able to see that male red flash has this sex pouch here, this pheromone pouch, which distinguishes a female from the male, mainly in most of the blues. It is like that, because we have got a slate flash male here with this pouch, and a slate red flash male with a pouch. So this, and also you will also find that the bands in the wing, we see that this band, this both the top and the bottom of this post-discal band, it is having a white margin. Can you see this white margin? Both the top and the bottom. Whereas in a red flash, this margin at the bottom of the wing is somewhat faded. It is somewhat faded. And of course, in most of the specimens which are found in the field, the line, the red flash line, this line is very thin as compared to the slate flash. Slate flash lines are a bit broader as compared to the red flash lines. This is one of the very common feature to distinguish between a red flash and a slate flash. But of course, you need a trained pair of eyes, because mostly red flash and slate flash, they look the same. And one more very important thing you can distinguish between a red flash and a slate flash by looking at the cilia. As I told you, cilia are the hair on the screen, on the wing. The cilia of a red flash is always red. This is always red. And that makes it very easy for you to identify whether it's a red flash or a slate flash. Okay. So this, and in a slate flash, the cilia is gray. Of course, the slate flash female and the slate flash males are quite distinctive. The females have a grayish wing, upper wing and the hind wing, upper wings, upper side of the hind wing and the fore wings. Whereas the male is more vibrant in color, with dark blue to black on the wings. Okay. And apart from these two flashes, we have one more flash in the Western Guard that's called Malabar flash, which is pretty uncommon, and it is found way deep inside the Western Guards. And one more flash which has never been recorded from Western Guards, but it is up to Madhya Pradesh it is found. It is called copper flash. So I am taking copper flash because it may happen in future that there may be a range extension of copper flash also. It's my doubt, because when common tit can be found in Karnataka, then why not copper flash? So since it is found till Kanha and nearby areas, so we can think about finding this copper flash here. It is at a distinctive spot here, which is absent in other flashes. It is not there. And this copper flash is recorded from Kanha, the nearest to our Western Ghat area. So I'm just given because many other flashes are there. Of course, there are many other flashes. If you talk about common flash, there are there are other flashes which are found in Himalayas which look similar, but there is something called scarlet flash, Malaya red flash. So they are very similar species. It's very difficult to identify them with mere pictures. Okay, we need to have opening and the close wing for both these butterflies to identify. No, it is not difficult for us, for Bangaloreans, to identify between a slate flash and a red flash. Mainly the cilia or the bands, the thinner bands, possibly the red flash, and the thicker band, possibly the slate flash. Okay, I'll just go to the next slide. Any questions on this? Anyone? Any questions on this?
None for me, sir.
Thank you. I'll go to the next slide. Okay. I have not finished all the flashes. So there is another flash called the indigo flash. Okay. And it is very similar to a butterfly, which is cornelian. Both are very similar in looks. But there are distinctive differences between a cornelian and a indigo flash. Open wing, there is no issue. But close wing, there is an issue. Many of the cornelians are being misidentified as indigo flashes. The main thing is we look at this band in the forewing, which is almost similar for indigo flash and a cornelian. Very broad and having a white band in the both the side. But there are differences, as you can see. But the main difference is this post-discal band, this band, this in the hind wing is broken in cornelian, which is not the case with a indigo flash. An indigo flash has a continuous band in the hind wing, and a cornelian has a broken band in the hind wing, which makes it quite distinctive from the indigo flash. Okay, and also one more thing which is to be taken into mind, that in both the species, we will see that this end cell band, this is the end cell band, it touches the discal band. This is something which is unique in indigo flash, which is not the case with red flash and slate flash. In slate flash and red flash, if you see, these bands are separate. These two bands are separate. Even in red flash, slate flash also, these two bands are separate. But in indigo flash, you will find that this band touches this post-discal band. This post-discal band is being touched by the end cell band, which is almost the same case with cornelian. But as you can see, this band is broken, which makes it different from indigo flash. One more very interesting feature is the difference between a red flash and a cornelian open wing. The most distinctive feature between the cornelian and the red flash open wing is the presence of a very dark patch at the top. You see, can you see this? This dark patch here is always present in a cornelian and which is not present in a red flash. It is never present in a red flash. So they both of them look very similar, but this dark patch on the cell, the cell patch, this is dark cell for a cornelian, and there is no color in the cell for a red flash. That is the very unique difference between a red flash and a cornelian. Of course, these flashes have one pair of tails. These flashes have one pair of tails. That makes it different from the royals, because royals have two pairs of tails always. That is one of the main difference between royals and a flash. So if you see a butterfly which may look like a flash, could be a royal if you see the number of tails. Okay, if the number of tails are more than two, it is a royal. If it is a pair of tails, it is a flash. Okay, that's how we distinguish between flashes. And of course, there are this false eyes at the back of a flash, which even the royals also have this false eye at the back. This is for their mimicry. And of course, the four wing colors are quite distinctive in indigo flash. Any questions in this too? Any questions from your side? Hello? Any questions? Okay.
No,
please,
sir.
Stop me if you have doubts.
Yes, sir.
Now, this is Goa blues. You know, there are two Goa blues found in Bangalore. Both of them are available. The large Goa blue and the common Goa blue. See, the difference is very... one more thing happens. This often looks like a cornelian. This Goa blue, common Goa blue, looks like a cornelian. Can you see the cornelian here? The cornelian has a black eyes, and the Goa blue has a... Hello?
Hello?
I am getting echo. Somebody has switched on the mic.
Yes.
Hello? So this Goa blue has a paler eyes. You can see the eyes of this Goa blue. It is brown. It is not black. Whereas the cornelian eyes are always black. That makes it different from... Sometimes in the field or a photograph, you get confused between a Goa blue and a cornelian also. So, and of course, the Goa blues have a different set of open wing. The female and the male. This is a male having blue and the female having brown and this orangish patch on the wing. That is the female. And all the features are quite similar to a cornelian. But the thing is, the post-discal band, this band end cell, it never touches the post-discal band. They're always separate, which is not the case with your cornelian. Cornelian, it touches, but in Goa blue, it never touches. And the difference between a large Goa blue and the common Goa blue lies in the fact of a spot. Can you see this spot? This spot is not present in common Goa blue or the Indian Goa blue. It is present only in the large Goa blue. Of course, they coexist together and breed together on fruits. That is pomegranate fruits and Goa fruits. So sometimes it is difficult for us to identify the caterpillars, but they are distinctly different. I'm not talking about caterpillars here. Okay. So next slide. Can I go? Yeah.
Yes, sir.
The sunbeams. sunbeams. So in southern part of a country, we have got three sunbeams: the Indian sunbeam, the Shiva sunbeam, and the angle sunbeam. Now, this angle sunbeam is also found in northeast, and it coexists with a butterfly called the bright sunbeam. Okay, so I'll not go into details of that, but still I'll try to make you understand the difference. The difference is quite evident. See, this Indian sunbeam is almost markless. There are no marks. There are no bands. It is pure white, milky white, the Indian sunbeam. And the female and the male, you can see very easily. This is the male of the Indian sunbeam, the female of the Indian sunbeam. And the Shiva sunbeam has a very distinctive broad mark, which lies always above your band and cell. This is the band and cell. It's always lie above. And it's a very distinct mark which travels from the apex to the base of the wing. It is prominent in the forewing, and it is not possibly depends upon the species individual also. It is not that prominent in the hind wing. Whereas in the angle sunbeam, which coexists in the same domain of a Shiva sunbeam and the Indian sunbeam, the difference is this band, can you see in the hind wing? This band is in line with the band and cell, which makes it different from the bright sunbeam, where this band is separate from the band end. The band and cell is not properly visible here, but there is a band here, and these two band, this one and this one. If you can make out, there's a band here, which is the band and cell, and there's a band here, which is the extension of the discal band. This post-discal band of the acute sunbeam or the tooth sunbeam, the part of the hind wing is in line with the in the band and cell, which makes it different from the bright sunbeam. Otherwise, in the field, you'll be easily able to distinguish between a Shiva sunbeam and a angle sunbeam. And of course, if you get the open wing, that makes it very, very clear for you. In the angle of the tooth sunbeam, you have a tooth on the cell. It is inside this. Can you see this? There's a tooth here. If I can, if I can increase this. Okay. I'll try to increase the size. Zoom out. Zoom in. Can you see this?
Yes.
In the tooth sunbeam, you can see that this is a tooth here. In the tooth here, which is not available with the Shiva sunbeam. This tooth is missing in the Shiva sunbeam, whereas in the acute sunbeam, the tooth is available, very distinctive tooth. This is only available with your tooth sunbeam. That's why it is sometimes called curitis dentata or curitis acuta. So acuta dentata, sometimes it is called, but it is now called as the curitis dentata. It's all sometimes, why there is a difference, I don't know. Acuta dentata, somewhere it is curitis dentata, I don't know why. Because this is the photograph which is by me, not from IF. I found that's why it is showing curitis dentata. My actual name is curitis acuta dentata. This is a new name. Don't go by this name. Okay. Actual name is curitis acuta dentata, that is tooth sunbeam or the angle sunbeam. And in the Shiva sunbeam, the tooth is missing. The tooth is missing, and the hind wing, see the difference. And Indian sunbeam, see the it's totally red. Indian sunbeam, the hind wing, the upper side of the hind wing is totally red, which is not the case with either Shiva sunbeam or the angle sunbeam. Both are having red patches, orange patches with dark brown coverings. This is all about your sunbeams. Any questions on sunbeams? Any questions on sunbeams?
One question, sir. These orange and white banded legs for the Indian sunbeam. I don't see that in Shiva sunbeam or the two sunbeams. So is that one of the...
you have told me this, so it is kind of noticeable to me now. Sorry. Okay, what has happened? One second. Where were we? So let me try to increase and try to see whether it is possible to see it or not. Yeah. But you know, this there's a distinctive pattern of orange and white in the legs of the Indian sunbeam. There are some patterns in the Shiva sunbeam also, but the issue is this is more prominent, and in the field it is very difficult to actually see the legs. If you take a photograph and see it, look it closely, you will find the difference. Otherwise, looking at a glance and to a butterfly setting and puddling somewhere, because these butterflies are known to puddle, both Indian sunbeam, Shiva sunbeam, and acute sunbeam, all the three. So it is something which has to be post-photographic identification, not pre-photographic identification. So thank you, Murugan. I think it is Murugan, na?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Murugan, for even I never knew that. Even it was new for me that you told me. Thank you for finding this out. So this is about sunbeams. So I will just proceed further and go to the next slide, which is the hedge blues. Very interesting and sometimes very appealing also, you know, talking about hedge blues. So in South India, we have got the most common, the common hedge blue, where you can see the distinctive two features are there. First feature, the presence of a spot here. Can you see this spot where my mouse is there? Hello. This is called a spot at 2B. Can you see this spot?
Yes, sir.
This spot is only present in common hedge blue and the lilac hedge blue. It is absent from all other hedge blues. Maybe white hedge blue, maybe white disc hedge blue, maybe plain hedge blue. You will not find this spot, as I'll show you. And the second distinguishes is this line, this spot and this spot makes a division symbol or a percentage symbol, you can say, whatever it is. This is a very unique feature. And this curve, it is not in line. This is always broken. If you make an imaginary line or a curve from the points touching the tips of the post-discal, the discal spots here, this is not a continuous. This is one of the main difference between the lilac hedge blue and the common hedge blue. Otherwise, both of them look very similar and same. If I go to the lilac hedge blue here, see the spot is still present here. But this line, this is a continuous line here. Can you see this line? This is quite different, distinctive. This post-discal spots, it is in a single smooth band, unlike the common hedge blue where it is broken. It is in broken and the division symbol is there. The division symbol is missing here. There is no division symbol. These three spots, 1, 2, and 3. And here also, 1, 2, and 3, it is quite different. This is elongated and having two spots. Okay, and the other hedge blues, if I talk about, see, in this plain hedge blue, there are no spots here. Can you see? There are no spots.
Yes.
And in white hedge blue, there are no spots. In the white disc hedge blue also, there are no spots. All the three hedge blues have no spots at the base. Okay, there is no spot. So that makes it very, very distinctive for them. And now you'll ask me how to distinguish with this white disc hedge blue, which is a very, very common question, how it is different from the plain hedge blue. I'll just make a bit more, I cannot go beyond this. You see, in this white disc hedge blue, this symbol, it is a staircase symbol. Can you see a staircase symbol here?
Yeah.
Here, one line comes, it goes down, it is a staircase symbol. Can you see the staircase silver mill? This is the peculiarity of this white disc hedge blue, where it is only high altitude species. So you'll have no problem in finding it in the high altitudes of Munnar. You can see that this pattern, this makes a kind of staircase pattern, which is not present in the plain hedge blue. Plain hedge blue is quite linear here. Can you see the bands here? It is quite linear, which is not the case in white hedge blue. This is a very unique distinctive feature between the white disc hedge blue and the plain hedge blue. Otherwise, they look almost the same, because if you go for these two spots which make it plain hedge blue, these two spots, these are all three hedge blues are having these two spots here. But white hedge blue is pure white. The color is very white and it is very distinctive in nature, and you will find this, there are the, that that marginal spots are very, very continuous, and they are not having any bands here. There are no bands. And other HQs, all the HQs are having bands. Can you see this band, zigzag band here, which is present in all the HQs except the white HQ? White HQ doesn't have that band. See, only spots are there. It is, as you see, the base color is a pretty white, pure white, which is not the case with any other HQ. It is having off a milky white, and it is pure white. That is the difference between HQ. And the third, which is sometimes commonly distinguished and confused, is the Malayan. We have the tailless Malayan, Magasiba malaya, this is the tailless Malayan species of subspecies of the Malayan found in the Western Ghats. The difference is these spots on this area margin. Can you see the 1, 2, 3, 4, and one spot rises from the margin and goes beyond. So that makes it quite different from HQs. Okay, all the HQs, if you see, they don't have tails. None of the HQs have tails. And our Malayan also doesn't have a tail. And one more thing about Malayan, it is a very small species. It is unlike HQs. It is very small, almost two-thirds of the size of a HQ. HQs are always bigger than Malayans. Malayans are smaller. And so there are spots here on the wing margin, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 spots, and the pattern of the wing at this point, this portion of the wing, which makes it quite different, because this line never touches in HQs. The margin is never touched by this band in HQs. That makes it different from a Malayan. Okay, so this is all about your Malayans and HQs. Any question on HQs? Hello? Any questions on HQs?
No, sir.
No.
I want people to participate. If you have doubts, please ask me questions.
Sir, so this is sir, one question.
Please.
Yeah. So, are these white disc HQ and white HQ available in Bangalore?
No. They are a high altitude species in Western Ghats. So, I have kept this, because in Bangalore we have got the common hedge blue, the plain hedge blue, and the lilac hedge blue. Lilac hedge blue is mainly found in the Kaveri basin, that area towards Tamil Nadu, not this side. We have not spotted lilac hedge blue. Maybe beyond Menargatta, if you go Tinsi, those places, you may find it. But it has not been reported here. Even Malayan was, I think, not reported, Rohit, from Bangalore proper.
No.
Rohit?
No.
No Malayan was reported in Bangalore. I have photographed this from very near to Bangalore. This is from Krishnagiri district.
There is one report of a Malayan. Only one solitary report.
I have photographed it from Krishnagiri. So this is the nearest to Bangalore.
This was, I think, on the outskirts, and then probably Nandi Hills or some place.
Okay. Okay.
How to differentiate on open wing, Ashokda?
Open wing, as you see, I don't have open wings for many butterflies, but if you the mainly one thing I'll tell you, these butterflies won't give you open wing chances. That is something which is only common HQ gives you open wing chance. It's very difficult to get the open wing of other HQs, because I have been in Munnar and other places trying my level best to get open wings of butterflies. These HQs, I failed. Malayan gives open wing, of course, but the common HQ, it is very easy to distinguish between a male and a female, because male is having very bright light blue color on the forewing, and the female is having gray and white, that dark gray and white, which makes it quite distinctive females. But other HQs, there are images on IAB, keep it a point and try to open IAB letter after this presentation is done. Let me find out whether it is possible to distinguish them from the open wing. Okay, but why it is called, our butterfly called white disc, because it is having the disc, the discal area of the butterfly is white. That's why it is called white disc as below. So it is very distinctively, but it is very difficult to find the disc of a butterfly without an open wing. And mostly these butterflies don't give you open wings. So it is difficult to get the open wing. That's why you have to rely on the underwing identification features. Okay. I may not be able to answer this particular question at this point of time. I'll see it later. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks. Thanks.
Now, the bubble blues. Okay. Many of you have been encountering bubble blues. There is a lot of confusion going on about bubble blues in Bangalore, of course. You know, after IFB has put a lot of bright bubble blues into, as dull bubble blues. Even I have no clue why they have been put into dull bubble blues. But still, you can see the difference between the two common ones, the bright bubble blue on to my left and the African bubble blue to my right. The bright bubble blue has these two spots, these coastal spots, which is very distinctive of the butterfly. If you see these two spots, blindly you say it is a bright bubble blue. And if you don't see these spots here, that makes it a African bubble blue or a Syrian bubble blue. Of course, there are other features also. You can see that in African or the Syrian bubble blue, there is one additional spot at the base of the wing, which is not the case with the bright bubble blue. Bright bubble doesn't have a spot here, whereas the African bubble blue is having a spot here. And there are these three spots are quite prominent here in African bubble blue, which is not that prominent in the bright bubble blue. That makes it, of course, if you see in the field, you'll be easily able to distinguish between the two. So they are so common and so prominently distinguished between themselves. Their distinguished features are so common and prominent that it will not be difficult for you to distinguish between the two. But the problem comes with the dull bubble blue. The dull bubble blue, they say, as the identification key says, I'll open this dull bubble blue. There'll be one or two spots at the this point, which is called the coastal spots. Okay, there will be one or two spots. And all the spots are very diminished in nature. In the underwing, all the spots are very diminished and very negligible and faded in nature. Not prominent as the bright bubble blue. These are very prominent, prominently, white crown spots are here. You know, these spots are very prominent white crown black spots. There are black spots, but they are not that prominent as the identification key says in the literature. But I don't know what has happened of late and why similar looking, bright bubble blues are placed under double bubble blue CF. That is yet to be confirmed. So I have not even yet got intimation or information from the owners of the moderators of I Found Butterflies why it has been done. Maybe some work is going on with the genitalia of bubble blues. So we'll be shortly coming to know about that. Till then, we have to rely on what we have learned from literature. And you can see the bright bubble blue, how it looks like the female and the male. The female has this color and the pale brown color, and the male is having the blue color. Similarly with the African bubble blue is having this kind of feature with which is very distinctive. But these bubble blues generally don't give you very good open wing shots. Most of the time you'll get lucky to get a close wing shot only. Okay, so this is about bubble blues. Any questions? Because I don't want to go beyond this in bubble blue. Any questions?
Yeah, hi, Ashok, Nagesh here. Yeah, I think it's going very well. Thank you very much.
Oh, well, thank you. Thank you, Nagesh. Yeah, okay, okay. So I'll come into the next slide.
So, Ashokda, once again, Vijay.
Yeah,
here.
Yeah, tell me, Vijay.
So the DSF can become a little more confusing, right? Or
yeah, always. When, see, especially the bright and the dull bubble blue DSFs, it is very, 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 very difficult to distinguish between the two. You know, almost no features. There? Actually, I tell you, though, when it is difficult to identify, you have to have a specimen and put another microscope. That is the final way to do it. Okay, there is no other way.
Okay.
Now, this dull bubble blue, the open wing is different. From, if you have the open wing, it is easy to identify. Okay. The bubble blue, the bright and the dull bubble blue, it's very easy to identify if you have the open wing. Okay, I don't have any shot of the open wing of dull bubble blue, so I'll not be able to show you. But that makes it very, very clear. It's quite distinctive. Okay.
Okay.
So that's how this is. Next one is. I'll go to the next. Tell me.
Can you tell me the geographical range of the dull bubble blue?
Actually, dull bubble blue has the confirmed report from Rajasthan, Gujarat, the western parts of the Madhya Pradesh, and northern parts of Maharashtra.
Okay.
And I don't know, why this is happening. We are getting, maybe there are some northern parts of Karnataka also. It is the dry area species. Dull bubble blue yes, Rohit.
There are some reports from Mysore, so we don't know, some old reports, so we don't know what is the reliability of that one, but there are some reports from Karnataka.
There are reports. Say, it is a dry area species, to be frank. It is not found in deciduous and moist deciduous areas. No way. Okay. So, we'll wait till the things are, properly revealed, this genus of Ajanus. The dull bubble blue. Okay. We may have another bubble blue somewhere, say, hiding in our country. We don't know about that. We'll see about that. We'll find out research, because there is something called the bubble blues, which are basically African in nature. So there are some bubble blues which are found in Africa, similar bubble blues found in India. There may be something hiding in between. We don't know. Let us not break our head onto that. We are happy with the three bubble blues available around us. See, the gram blues and the forget-me-nots. The gram blues and the forget-me-nots are often encountered by us in the field. Always, the most common blues found around us and which attract us a lot are these two, gram blues and the forget-me-nots. Of course, the pea blue is the third one. The pea blue is quite distinct from these two, so I have not put it in the frame here. So, the difference between the gram blue and the forget-me-not. The first difference, which is the last spot on post-discal band shifted down. This spot is away from the band. This is the first identification difference between gram blue and a plains cupid and a small cupid and a forget-me-not. So all the four look similar. The plains cupid, the small cupid, the gram blue and the forget-me-not. The gram blue, which is having this spot away from the discal band, which, and second very important part is these two black spots at the base of the hind wing are orange crowned and same in size, orange crowned and almost same in size, very prominent spots. Can you see these spots? These spots I'll show you. I'll just increase the here you can see these orange crown spots, very dark orange. Many butterflies have yellow crown spots, but this gram blue has a orange crown spots, and both the spots are same, almost same in size, and that makes it a gram blue. And this particular spot is away from this band. Okay, this is one difference. And if you see the forget me not, where there is one crown and there is a C. Can you see the C here? This C is very prominent in this band in the hind wing for a forget-me-not. And last but not the least, there is a spot at the costa. The costa, there is one spot which is pushed away from the discal band, post-discal band. This is a post-discal band. It's called the post-discal band. And the spot is pushed away. So, if you find a butterfly which spot is almost touching this post-discal band, we try to raise the alarm and call it a silver forget-me-not. Okay. Now, recently, silver forget-me-not has been reported from Chinnar. Possibly, they are found around us also, and there are unconfirmed records. We have to check it, and we have to find out this particular butterfly. It is possibly around us, not far from us. Of course, if you try, you can get it. This silver forget-me-not, which may coexist with our common forget me not. Okay. And you see that there's only one band, one spot here, very prominent spot. Unlike the gram blue, which has got two spots, it is having one spot and it is prominent and having a pale orange crown. Pale orange crown. And this crown is much more dark. Even this, you see, the color is very relative because depending upon the species, the seasonal form, and sometimes the age of the specimen, the colors may fade. So that may not be the very good indicators, but the indicator is this C and the spot. Even sometimes it happens, this spot is missing. You find a specimen in the field where this spot is gone. If the spot is gone, don't worry. Just look at this C. If the C is there, it's a forget-me-not. Okay. And the open wings are very, very distinctive in forget-me-not and the gram blue. There are two spots here. Can you see the two spots here? The two spots are there, and in forget-me-not, there is only one spot. There is only one spot. That makes it the male forget-me-not. And even in the female also, you can see there is only one spot, prominent spot at the base of the tail. You know, at the base of the tail is only one spot. In gram blue, at the base of the tail, there are two spots. That makes it different from the forget-me-not. Of course, the female, the male of the forget-me-not is much more brighter in color than the gram blue. Gram blue is having palish blue and a pinkish blue color. Okay, that is the difference between the gram blue and the forget-me-not. So I'll go to the next slide, which is more interesting. Okay, 1 minute. Aagya gram blue methana. I was in gram blue. Now I go to the next slide, which gives you the difference between gram blue and pea blue open wing. See how similar they are. It is very difficult to distinguish between open wing of gram blue and pea blue, especially females in the field. You have to be very careful in distinguishing the two. Okay, the distinguishing feature of the gram blue and the pea blue, of course, are the presence of the two spots at the base of the wing. If I just enlarge a bit, females, I'm not talking about the males. I'm not talking about the males. I'm talking about the females. Males, you can see very, very interesting. In pea blue, this is a very roundish kind of spot. This spot is very roundish, which is kind of, you know, off round, kind of flattened round or a beaten round off in the case of a gram blue. These are very minute observations you have to do to make it different from the, of course, the base color is quite different. The pea blue is a vibrant, you know, blue, and that blue is light in color, very kind of, that is not a very, very bright blue, dark deep blue. It is light blue, but very bright, this pea blue color. The specimen may be having a different angle because of that, it is not showing that particular color. But in gram blue, it is not that blue. And of course, the spot is quite flat, not purely round. The same is case with the females, which is more difficult to distinguish in the field. But you can see that in the forget-me-not, in the pea blue, the spot, the second spot is very kind of, it's insignificant. There are two spots. Both the cases, there are two spots. In gram blue, the two spots are very prominent, orange crowned. But in the pea blue, they are not orange crowned, and one of the spot is very, very feeble in nature. That's how we distinguish between the two. Otherwise, they both look almost the same. And sometimes you may say that, okay, the gram blue wings are not that pointed and pea blue wings are quite pointed. That's the difference between the pea blue and the gram blue in the field. When you have a photograph, try to compare this with this photograph and try to find out the difference. I come to the next slide, which is plain cupid, the small cupid, and the lime blue. Okay. Now, often we get to know to find these two, plain cupid and small cupid, together. But plain cupid is a city butterfly and the small cupid is a dry area butterfly, whether acacia plantation is there, because this the small cupid breeds on acacia, and the plains cupid breeds on mostly on cycas palm. Okay, the difference is quite obvious when you see the small cupid. Two orange crowns are very prominent and almost similar in these two spots almost same in size, which is not the case with the plains cupid. One spot is bigger, the other spot is smaller. This is how one difference. The second difference, sometimes it is there, sometimes it is not there. The presence of a fourth spot, which is only present in the case of plains cupid, and it is never the case with a small cupid. This spot here is missing. And it is always present in the case of a plains cupid. But sometimes, because of aging or because of some aberration, this spot is missing. Not always, but most of the time, we'll find the plains cupid. The spots are present. Of course, plains cupid are much more common in the city, and small cupids are not that common. Small cupids are found in the outer skirts of Bangalore. In the, you know, you go to Benargatta, go to Hesargatta, you'll find them in loads. But here in city, you'll mainly find the plains cupid. Okay. Of course, there's a difference between the males of when you see the colors of the wings, open wing almost same for plains and the small cupid, but still you will be able to make out the difference between the pattern in the margin of the wings. The pattern of the margin of the plains cupid is quite different in the males of the small cupid. There are not many markings here, and the margin is quite plain in the case of small cupid, whereas there are bands and prominent, you know, some zigzag patterns in the plains cupid. Okay, the females, of course, you will be able to see them, easily in the city side. They almost look similar. Females of plains cupid and the small cupid, they look similar. Not much difference. But still, you may try to find out, because I could not figure out many difference between the female of plains cupid and the small cupid. The only difference I could find is the margins are very prominent in the plains cupid female, which is not that prominent in the small cupid female. It is a kind of depleted marginal bands, and here it is quite prominent marginal band. That is the difference I could find in a plains cupid and a small cupid. Even the third butterfly, the lime blue, which is quite distinctive, because if you compare it with a plains cupid, you'll find, okay, there is a spot here. Sometimes we get confused with a plains cupid and a lime blue, because the fourth spot is here also. But the difference is the four-winged post-discal band is continuous here. It is a continuous band, and which is not the case with a lime blue, which is always broken. And you will see that this broken spots, not a continuous band, and that makes it different from your plains cupid. So sometimes, even if you quickly try to identify a butterfly and you see that at the for this spot, oh, this is a lime blue, but it is not a lime blue. We sometimes, even experts, they with a haste, they will try to ID a lime blue as a plains cupid, because they will look at this point and not look at this band. So that we have to be very careful in looking at both the places, the band as well as the spot. Okay.
Sir, I have one question on plains. Please. Cupid.
Uh-huh.
They say that in plains cupid there are 3+1 spots.
Uh-huh.
Does the spot number vary?
No, there will be maximum 4 spots. Sometimes the fourth spot is missing. The intermediate spot is additional discal band spot is missing. Okay. Additional spot is missing sometimes. Okay, it is because of aging, fading, aberrations, it happens. But that is the time when you have to see the tail, that these two spots here, one is large and one is almost negligible. That makes it different from a small cupid. But in small cupid, it's just like a gram blue. The spot, two spots are very, very prominent. Very prominent. But the thing, this spot is not shifted as in gram blue, it is shifted. In gram blue, it is shifted down. In plains cupid, it is not shifted down. That is the difference between the gram blue and a... See, in the gram blue, this spot, this particular spot, this one, this is shifted down, broken. But in plains cupid and in small cupid, these are touching this post-discal band. That makes it different from a gram blue. Okay.
Okay.
Was it Sam? Samanvita?
Swati.
Swati. Okay. Thank you, Swati.
Yeah. Hello,
sir. Tell me.
Lime Hello? Blue doesn't have a tail.
Lime blue never have a tail. Yeah, that is a very good answer. So we have got all people knows. Lime blue never has a tail, but you know, sometimes you get a planescupid, a tailless planescupid also broken. That is okay. I missed it. You are very correct that lime blues, hedge blues don't have tails. That is the most fundamental identification key, as rightly pointed out. Lime blues never have tails. Whereas the other gram blues and cupids and you know, forget me nots have. P blues have a tail. Okay, thank you very much. Who was the who gave the answer?
Nagraj, sir, Nagraj.
Oh my God, my boss is there. Okay, thanks for pulling me up.
No problem, sir. No, sir, not at all.
Okay, now the parrots. I am coming to some weird parrots now after this. So this is the common parrot, and there is the angle parrot and the banded blue parrots. These are these are very commonly found around. All the three I think are available in Bangalore. Common parrot, the banded blue parrot, and the angle parrot. They have been reported from Bangalore. And you see, the common parrot is not an issue. So common parrot is, there is a road here. Can I'll just make it enlarge first. Okay, what has happened? Why this is changing? Okay, now let me pull it. So you see, common parrot, there is a rasta. Can you see the road here? This area is totally vacant road. So, and why I'm giving you this identification? Because you in the Western Ghats, you will find a similar parrot called the dark parrot. It looks very similar to common parrot. Unlike the other parrot, the dark parrot looks very similar to a common parrot. The difference is in the hind wing, you will find that in common parrot, there is a gateway and there is a star. 1, 2, 3, 4 spots, regular spots. 1, 2, 3, and 4. Here, this is not there. These four spots, 1, 2, 3, 4. That makes a kind of, that Ludo of kind of spots. 1, 2, 3, 4. There are four spots here, which is not the case with a common pair, which is not. Otherwise, they look almost the same. If you compare the both of them, the dark parrot and the common parrot, they look almost the same. The difference is that different in family. The genus is also different. The family is same. The genus, one is a Taruca species and another is a Castilius rosimon. That genus is different, but they look similar. The dark parrot and they breed also the same host plant. The host plant is the Gigipus bear, we say in Hindi. The Gigipus plants, they breed the common parrot as well as the dark parrot. Of course, these two parrots, the banded blue parrot and the angle parrot also breed on the same host plant, the Gigipus, and they look similar. With the difference you can see that this band is available only in banded blue parrot, which is not the case with a angle parrot. Can you see this? This band is not complete. That makes it different. Can you see this? This band is incomplete in case of angle parrot, and which is complete in the case of banded blue parrot. And that is probably the reason they are called. This is called the banded blue parrot, and this is called the angle parrot. And angle parrot is called because of this angle also. In the forewing, there's an angle here. Can you see this angle? A right angle is there. And this angle is not very prominent in the banded blue parrot. And of course, there are other spots also. This is a tiny spot here. And there is a big spot over here. This spot is there. This spot is missing. So there are very, very unique differences between these two species. And easily, the easiest identification is the presence of the band, this band at the base, and absence of the band at the base. That makes it different from each other. Easiest way to identify. Of course, there are there are other differences also. There are that marginal spots here in banded blue parrot, which is missing in the angle parrot. There are no marginal spots in the angle parrot. So it will be easy for you to distinguish between the two if you see them. So I'll go to the next slide. quickly I'll try to finish. Common cerulean versus dark cerulean versus metallic cerulean. So common cerulean is pretty common around us. It is a big, almost the size of a common cerulean, if you see, it is almost 1.3, 1.4 times that of a dark cerulean. And the dark cerulean, you see the discant band, the post-discal band is continuous. There are dry season. I know I will make increase the size. This is a dry season form, but you see that this band is continuous here. And in this case, the band is also continuous for common cerulean. In the dark cerulean, this band is broken. Can you see this band is broken? Always it is broken. Of course, four wing colors are very different from each other. This smaller butterfly, they breed on the same host plant, you know, in Pongami and the Hongemara. They breed on Hongemara, they breed on any flowers of, you know, if you say this, what do you say, the Fabaceae trees, those P type of items they breed, P trees, you know, having that kind of flowers. This particular band is broken in dark parrot and dark cerulean, and in common cerulean this band is not broken. The metallic cerulean is a bit similar, but how it is different from your dark cerulean is, see, these bands are paler in color. These bands are very pale. It is almost visible. Somehow it's visible, but it is very, very distinctive in nature for metallic cerulean. Of course, this band is broken. This band is broken, as in the case of your the dark cerulean. But this is white spots. Always you'll find this cerulean with white spots, white markings, very prominent, and is a bigger butterfly, almost double the size of your dark cerulean. And it is found mainly in the Western Ghats, not found here in Bangalore. When you go to Western Ghats, you find a cerulean which looks like a common cerulean, but with a broken this post-discal band. You think it is a metallic cerulean and not a common cerulean, because both of them coexist together in the same place. This is the difference between cerulean. Now, line blues, common line blue, the tailless line blue, and the white tip line blue. All the three line blues are found in our city limits. The common line blue is having a tail. The tailless line blue doesn't have a tail. So sometimes the common line blue without a tail is referred as a tailless line blue. We try to mistake it. But if you see them very carefully, you'll see that there are very, very, unique difference between the two species. They may coexist together in the same area, but I have not selected possibly the best photographs to show you, but you'll see that in the tailless line blue is quite more elaborative in their patterns of the hindwing. The patterns in the hindwing, especially the marginal area, is more elaborative with the white and gray. This zigzag bands are there here, which is not very prominent in the common line blue. Of course, the main difference is the presence and absence of tail. Sometimes it happens that the common line blue tail is broken because of some attack by a predator or something, or aging or something like that. It will be difficult for you to find it out, but still, we can manage to distinguish them by comparing them with the photographs. Line blues are a bit tricky to ID, especially when you go to the Nakaduba line blues. I'll not go to Nakaduba line blues in my series, but there is a white tip line blue. I'll show you the difference between white tip line blue. First of all, common line blue and white tip line blue, the difference is there is no tail. In tailless, it is similar to a tailless line blue, but this crown is very prominent. In white-tipped line blue, the tips are white. The tips are white, which is not the case with tailless line blue. The white tip is called because the tips are white, and there is a very distinguished this particular band. This band never crosses the limit here. This is the place where the band is missing. In case of the other line blues, this band is continuous. This band extends. This band extends beyond the cell, but it doesn't extend beyond the cell here for the white-tipped line blue. I can see them in the field and try to distinguish. And this crown is, this spot is never crowned with yellow, orange. There is no orange crown on this always. It is crownless. A white crown is there, but not an orange crown. You may find a tail line blue with a orange crown always. It is not a very good specimen, but here you see that there is no crown. That is the difference between white tailed lime blue. It is very rare. This was actually photographed in Bangalore. We have photographed them in, I think, JP Nagar also, Rohit? Rohit, you have found it in JP Nagar.
Yes, sir. You know.
Jala Ali, JP Nagar, I think it is found in Bangalore University also, BU also.
Yes.
This is it is a scheduled one species, and one very peculiar thing about this is the life cycle of this butterfly has not been done yet. Nobody has been able to do the life cycle of this butterfly. So Paresh is trying to do it. I don't know. We could not find. It is found in my campus, unfortunately or fortunately. I am trying since last so many years to get a glimpse of the early stages. I could not get it. So hopefully we'll get it this year. Okay. Next. Grass blues.
Sir,
please tell me.
The lime blues, what is the
LHP? LHP is, you know, there are varied LHPs. Acacia is the main LHP. And mainly they breed on flowers. Acacia or Senegalia, we call it now. Senegalia, Cateshu, and there are Acacia, which is having flowers. Basically, they will breed on flowers.
Okay.
Flower buds.
Okay.
Mainly, we'll find them in. Even I have reports of lime blue breeding on Moria. That is your what is the flowers of your curry leaves? Recent photographs. Okay. Yeah. Confirmed records of lime blue breeding on your curry leaves flowers. Because it breeds on flowers.
Curry leaves can attract them possibly.
Possibly, but I don't know. I found it. The records are from Central India. I don't have a record from South. Okay. Recently, I got this record from Central India. They're breeding on your curry leaves. Okay, thank you. The grass blues, the pale grass blue, which is bigger in size always, of all the three grass blues, the pale grass blue is the largest in size, biggest in size. And the difference between a pale grass blue and a dark grass blue, by looking at the first glance, is the curvature in this basal band. The basal band is a curved. Can you see the curve here? Curve is there. In the case of a dark glass blue, this is a straight band. Can you see the straight? There is no curvature. That's how, and it is a smaller butterfly always. It is smaller than the pale grass blue always, generally. Okay. And of course, you see that the spot here is elongated. This spot is always elongated, but this is not always the case. Generally, it is elongated, the third spot, center spot in the forewing, it is elongated. And these three lines, this is a straight line. There is no curvature here, which you find in this pale grass blue. Pale grass blue is always a curve. It's a continuous curve can be prepared, but here you cannot have the curve. That's how it is different from each other. And the lesser grass blue, these two spots are shifted out. Always, but you say, okay, sir, this particular spot is elongated. That doesn't mean that it is a dark glass blue. These spots are always shifted from the ring. This ring, the post-discal ring, the band, these spots are shifted. Hey, last few days back, the one question came, somebody was posting up an image of a lesser, trying to find out the ID keys of lesser grass blue. That's very simple. These two spots are shifted out, is a lesser grass blue. Okay, the tiny grass blue, the Gigilla hilux, it's the smallest of the butterflies, the blues, the smallest blue found in India. You'll find the distinguished feature is no tail. There are no tail. Of course, the grass blue doesn't have tails. And the smallest, there is a C here. Can you see the C here? The reverse inverted C. This C is available in, that's how we identify it quickly. This the one spot which is shifted out from the band, it is a reverse inverted C, whatever you say, reverse tumbler you can say. This is the commonest feature of this pale, that is tiny grass blue, which is smallest of all the grass blues. But sometimes a lesser grass blue is as small as a tiny grass blue. Lesser grass blue can compare in size with the tiny grass blue often. Now, I'll go to the next one. I think, okay. Now, this is grass blues over. You see that female of the dark pale grass blue is quite different from the female of the dark grass blue. The females are very easy to, open wings are very easy to identify. But close wing, it takes some time because we have to look at the various spots. The Taruga species. How many of you are interested? All of you?
Yes.
Huh?
Yes.
Yes.
I have not all the tarukas here.
Yes, sir.
Three tarukas I have given. I will discuss the fourth tarukas if we have time. Okay. The which is there are many about how many tarukas are there? There are 8 taruka species found in India. Is it correct or 6 or 8? Tell me. I'll tell you the taruka species found in India. You have 3 here: the rounded pero, the spotted pero, the balkanicus or the little tiger pero, the Indian pero. This is 4, and 2 found in Himalayas. One is one more is the dark pero. Okay, there are 3, 4, 5 is here. 5 is found in South India. Okay, the fifth, the 5 are the rounded pero, the little tiger pero, the spotted pero, and the dark pero, the Tarukas Ananda. And 2 found in Himalayas are the veined pero and the and what do you say that that dark velvet that is that Hazara, Tarukas Hazara, and 1 found in the northeast, that is the Tarukas Dhartha. Total is 8. Okay, I'll not discuss about all the 8. The common ones I'll discuss here. Okay, I'll talk about the rounded pero, how to distinguish them by looking at the external features. I'll tell you the disclaimer is the 90% times I'll be correct, 10% times I may be wrong. So please bear with my 10% mistake here. Okay, let us talk first about the simpler one. The simpler one is this.
Around, sir.
Huh?
Hello.
Huh?
We are 90% of time we are wrong. Only 10% of time we are correct.
No. It's not like that. Okay. So, okay. I will compare first your rounded pero and the spotted pero. In the spotted pero, the 3 spots here. Can you see this spot and the hind wing? This and this. Can you see? These 3 spots are equidistant. They are equidistant always. Can you see this? This spot and this spot on the hind wing. Okay, spot at 4, 5 and 6 are equidistant. Or 5, 6 or 7. Sorry, 5, 6 and 7. And the veins 5, 6 and 7 are equidistant. That is always there. We cannot know, but the Tarukas calinara is having a spot which is a differently oriented. And secondly, these spots, that's why spotted, the post-discal band is broken into spots. Can you see this? It is broken into spots. Can you see this? Broken spots here, all of you?
Yes.
And the equidistant spots, can you see this? Equidistant spots? The spots are equidistant. 1, 2, 3 equidistant. That is very easy now. Now, anybody who sees the Tarukas calinara can easily identify, okay, this is Tarukas calinara. Okay, there should not be any doubt about this one. In rounded pero, that the ulta. First is, this discal band is continuous, it is not broken. Can you see? Is it broken here? Is it broken?
No.
Secondly, not broken now, it is joined.
Yes.
It is joined. Here it is broken. Here it is broken, here it is joined. Can you see?
Yes, sir.
First difference. Second difference is the second spot is closer to the first spot. This one, that is 6 and 7 are close to each other, and fifth is away. Fifth is away. This is a classical example I'm talking about. The very, very classical species or specimen species which are used for identification. Can you see this 3 spot orientation? They are not closely, they are not equidistant as in the case of Tarukas calinara, but one spot is closer to the other, but not touching. But not touching. Can you see?
Yes.
And second point is this band here in the forewing. Can you see this band here? This band never drops down. This curvature is straight. This curvature is straight. Can you see this curvature? This is always straight. This doesn't bend down. I'll show you in the Tarukas other species where it is bent. And you see this one. You see this Balkan. This is Balkanicus, classical Balkanicus. The difference. Now, it will be always a question how to distinguish. I'll tell you. Always this spot and this spot are in line. You can draw a line. Can you see? And they are touching the spot. These two are touching and These are in line. And similarly, this and this spot are in line. We can draw a horizontal line here to the scale and they will be always in line. They will always in line. And you see here, this is not in line. This is not in line. This is not in line. These two spots are not in line. But here see, this spot is always in line with this spot. This spot is always in line with this spot. And second is this curvature is pretty more curve. This curve is much more prominent than in the case of Tarukas Nara. Can you see? This is a straightish curve and there is always a pakka curve here. Pakka curve. That makes it different from Tarukas Balkanikas. First difference is the line is continuous, more continuous than in the case of Nara. Can you see? Nara is still having some ladder-like structure, some staircase-like structure, but it is more continuous band in Tarukas Balkanikas. And this spot is in line. If you draw a scale line, it will be straight. If you draw this scale, it will be straight. And third is, if you see the curvature is very, very sharp, which is not the case in Tarukas Nara. That's how we can differentiate between Tarukas Nara and Tarukas, that is Balkanikas. Okay. This is a very, very, you know, this is how over the year of past, these are not recorded keys. Nowhere these keys are recorded. These are my observations by looking at more than 1,000 species of each. 1,000 individuals, more than 1,000 individuals. Okay. That is my identification keys. I am not going to write because all day the paper is published and so I don't, nothing to be hidden. Everything is in the black and white now. You can see the difference between the two. And in Tarukas Indica, which is generally not yet recorded from, there are some old records from Mysore, they say, but I am not sure. But Tarukas Indica is, the difference is, it is similar to Tarukas Nara. And the difference I found in Tarukas Indica is, I'm not having a photograph here. There is a spot here. Can you see? Black, sorry, there is a longish spot here. This spot is elongated. This spot is quite elongated. And this particular spot on the hind wing is lying diagonally over this spot. This spot is lying diagonally over this. So if you see that the confirmed species of Tarukas Indica, you will see that this horizontal line and there is a spot which is lying diagonally on it, as if a wicket is kept with over another wicket. One stump you keep it on another wicket, there will be a diagonal placing of one stump over other, and you'll see the difference. I'll show you at the end of this particular session the Tarukas Indica for sure. Okay, now see the difference between the hind wings and the open wings. See, there are 1, 2, 3, 4 spots. You see the spots here. And in Nara, it is a single bright spot on the forewing, which is not the case in Balkanikas. Balkanikas has got many more spots. And next, we go to the Tarukas Kalinara. You see, in Nara and Kalinara, there are similar spots at the forewing. But in Nara, there is a spot at the base of the wing, which is not present in the Tarukas Balkanikas. Sorry, Tarukas Kalinara. In Kalinara, there is no spot at the base of the wing. Forewing. Can you see? And don't try to distinguish the females. It is not easy. I'm not going to explain the female keys, which will be very difficult for this session. It will be very complex and complicated. I don't want to do that. Females, almost they look similar. And I don't want to discuss about the females in details here. But in males, you can see that there is a spot in Nara, which is not the case with the Kalinara. And in Balkanikas, there are more than one spot in the forewing. Okay, that's how we differentiate between the three. Okay, and in Tarukas Indica, this spot on the forewing is inconspicuous. Inconspicuous means it is hardly visible. It is not complete. It's an incomplete spot, and the wings are transparent. The wings are transparent. That means not fully transparent, but you can see the patches and the stripes of the forewing or the hind wing, sorry, not hind wing, or the under part of the wing by the open wing. You can see them. It is visible. partially visible. That also that makes it a transparent Peiro or Indian Peiro. That's the difference. They almost look same, the Taricus Nara and the Taricus Indica, but this spot is inconspicuous. That means it's incomplete and the wings are a bit transparent. That's the difference between Nara and Indica. Any questions on Taricus, please?
Sir, what about this Taricus venosus?
I'll tell you, at the end of the show, I'll go discuss about venosus. Venosus and Hazara, these two species are found in the Himalayan, Western Himalayan regions only. Only. If people are saying that they have found Taricus venosus in Eastern Himalayas, they are wrong. All those species found in the Eastern Himalayas or the Assam are all one form of Taricus balkanicus only. There are no reports of Taricus venosus from the eastern part of our country. They are only found in the Uttarakhand, the Kashmir, and your Himachal Pradesh. These two, these three zones, and at mid elevations in the Himalayas, they are found, and the valleys they are found. And Hazara and Taricus venosus, they breed on the same plant, in the same place, at the same time. So it is very difficult to distinguish between the two. I have tried my level best. Only genitalia is the way to find out the difference. Because what we have collected and official collections from those areas, we thought them to be venosus, but they came out to be Hazara after dissection. So we don't actually know the physical keys between the actual difference between this venosus and Hazara until unless we have more than 100 specimens with us. If you have more than 100 specimens of similar open wing underwing, then we can compare them. But we don't have that many number of specimens. We have few specimens. They have been dissected, and we have found the difference between the genitalia of this Hazara and venosus. But live specimen, life cycle of venosus and Hazara both have been done. Both have been done, and still there are confusions. So that confusions maybe in a subsequent paper will try to decipher that particular. There may be interbreeding also. We don't know. Nobody knows what is happening actually there. You know, there may be evolutioning. Evolution between the interspecies breeding. It may be also be happening because Taricus is a very 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 evolving kind of genus. A lot of things are happening. Many species, where photographs we come across, they look so similar and confusing that, you know, I said 10%, that 10% amount of error always happens. Okay. Any more questions? Should I proceed?
Sir, one more question. This balkanicus and venosus, how can you identify?
First of all, I tell you, when you see the balkanicus, that hindwing, it looks like Taricus Nara. Any doubts?
No.
Almost Taricus Nara. But in case of venosus and Hazara, both look very brightly spotted Calilara. You see them now in the IFB. They look similar to Calilara, not Nara. The spots are broken. They are equidistant spots. That the keys I gave for you, Calilara, holds good for venosus too. Hello?
Yep.
The keys for Calilara, underwing keys, holds good for venosus too, as well as Hazara. The slight difference is there, but that difference may be true, may not be true. We need more specimens between among the two species. Okay?
Okay.
Now you can easily compare. You see any species which looks like Calinara from the Himalayas, that is not Calinara, that is venosus or Hazara. Okay. Hello. Is it okay? We are coming to the end of the show. Now the grass jewels. There are two grass jewels found here. One is the Oriental grass jewel and the grass jewel of the African grass jewel. The difference is quite prominent here. You can see that the orange crowns are very limited. Can you see? The orange crowns are very limited in the grass jewel, that Oriental grass jewel. And the orange crowns touch touch the post-discal band, and it's very broad. The orange crowns in trochoelus is very broad, and they almost, I count number of four. There are four spots are there, three spots are there. That is not the way to distinguish between the two. the main distinguishing feature is that is the orange crown is very, very prominent, and it almost touches the post-discal band. It touches the post-discal band in trochilus and putli. It is limited. It is very restrictive orange crowns. That is the only difference in the hindwing. There is no other difference. You cannot distinguish between the two. And you may say that, okay, the trochilus is a bit larger than the putli, but that's also not a very good comparison. Okay, it should not be compared that way. Only the comparison for till now, since we have got so many species and it is very easy to distinguish between the two. The putli has a orange crown, which is limited to the size, the circum that, and for the trochilus, it is quite broad and it touches the post discal band. You'll find it in the field very easily. Okay, ciliate blues, the pointed ciliate blue and the common ciliate blue. The common ciliate blue has one spot at the base, okay, and in pointed ciliate blue there is a spot at the costa, additional spot. Of course, there are base spot is also there. This pointed ciliate blue is very commonly found in Bangalore. This monsoon time, they will start arriving down very quickly. Beautiful blue you'll see, really mud puddling, and the blue is very prominent. And common ciliate blue, of course, is not found in Bangalore till now, not reported. May not be reported. It's a Western Ghats species. You'll find them in the Western Ghats. Okay, that's the difference between the common ciliate blue and the pointed ciliate blue. This presence of this spot here and the absence of this spot. That's how we distinguish them. This spot is very prominent in pointed ciliate blue. Okay, there should not be any difference between the two. It's very simple, easy to distinguish. Of course, there are tails are there. The tails are there, which are very pointed tails are there in both of them. Common doesn't have a tail, but pointed ciliate blue has a tail. Silver lines. Okay, I want to give you some focus on a few of the species because you'll be encountering. The disclaimer is I don't want to distinguish between common silver line and plumbear silver line by looking at the underwings. It is impossible. We cannot distinguish a plumbear silver line from a common silver line by looking at the underwings. It is not possible. There are no identification. If you know, please tell me. I don't know. Okay. There are no features to distinguish between the two. Secondly, the differentiation I want to tell you that there is no distinctive features between a common short silver line and a scare short silver line when you see the look at the underwing. There is no way, because we have got dry season form, various seasonal forms between common short silver line and scare short silver line. There is no way you can find out the difference between the common short and the scare short. So these are the disclaimers. I don't want to compare the underwings of common short and scare short, but of course I can compare the underwing of long banded silver line and common short or scare short. See, in long banded silver line, this particular band here, if I can increase a bit more, this band, this spot, discal spot, can you see this almost extends to the end. Some of the species will show, it is always elongated. It may sometimes restricted, it is not reaching the base of the wing, but in many of the species you will find that this spot reaches the end. That is the main feature of distinction between a long banded silver line. And of course, this band, the post discal band or marginal band, is continuous, and it is in the form of spots in commons of silver line. This is a long band, and of course there is a V here. This V is always there, which is not a pakka V in the case of common short silver line. You see, this spot is a spot here, not a elongated. There is no elongation here. It is on a spot. This is a spot which is separated from in common short silver line. This is always separated. This spot is always separated, which is not the case with long banded. It is touching. It's always all the three spots touch each other. But in common short silver line, this spot is always separated from the rest of the two. This is how it distinguish between common short silver line and long banded silver line. But the difference in the elema and the common short silver line, it is very prominent. As you can see, in scare short silver line, this blue is more prominent in the forewing. Can you see this blue? And the orange crown is very, very tiny. The orange crown is very tiny. In the case of common source silver line, this blue is not reaching to this particular crown, the orange crown, and this orange crown is very big. It is pretty large and pretty significant in the case of common short silver line male, and it is almost restricted and it is not that prominent, and a very small spot in the case of a scarce short silver line. Recently, there was a photograph clicked by Namrata and Arun at Mysore, and there was a debate between the couple that what is that. I don't know whether Arun was pulling the leg of Namrata and trying to tease her to make it something else, but ultimately Namrata gave the right ID and it was indeed a scarce of silver line. That was a good reporting from Karnataka. Okay, and the plumber silver line, only you can distinguish by plumber silver line by looking at the open wing, where you can see there are small blue fringes in the forewing, in the hind wing, that is not forewing, in the hind wing of this butterfly. When it opens, the small fringes of blue that makes it a plumber silver line. There is no other way you can distinguish. All females are also really difficult to ID, and they say that in this common that is plumber silver line, this yellow patch at the base is restrictive. This is restrictive, is small, but in common silver it is long. But still, these are not yet to be established properly. We don't know what actually the case is, and the behavioral also different. Common silver line is not coexisting with common short silver. That is not the plumber silver line. Plumber silver line reportings are done from various places in Tamil Nadu, even Karnataka. They are found Coorg, I think, in Honey Valley. They have been reported near Honey Valley, plumber silver line. And Bangalore, there is a chance of getting a plumber silver line, but yet to establish the confirmed fact of existence of a plumber silver line. I don't know whether there are reports, Rohit. Rohit.
No reports.
So we'll keep it as at advance, then we'll see whether we can find it. Next time you take a get open wing shots of silver line, and please keep it with you. Try to share with us. It may be a plumber silver line, and keep an eye after the lockdown opens. Okay. So I'll not go beyond this, because there are other silver lines also found in Western Ghats. One is found in Bangalore. Everybody knows that silver line, the lilac silver line. Another one which is found, which is abnormal silver line at higher altitudes of Munnar, and sometimes it is found in Bombay, etc. It has been reported there. I don't think there are reports of this abnormal silver line from Karnataka yet. We have not been, it has been not been reported. If there are literature, old literatures, they say that there are reports, but we even don't know whether they are there or not. Oak blues. Okay. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 oak blues in the peninsular India. There are 6 oak blues in peninsular India. The most common is the large oak blue, which is found everywhere, including my campus also. JP Nagar is the, dream destination for looking at this large oak blues. And we have got, apart from large oak blue, we have got this Indian oak blue, which is a kind of another kind of ghost in Western Ghats. None of the scientists has been able to actually find this Indian oak blue in Western Ghats. The reason behind that is they invariably breed on the Shoria robusta trees, the sal trees, sal forest. And sal forests are not found in the Western Ghats. So if you've any reports of any sal forest in Western Ghats? Hello?
No, actually the Shoria robusta is found in JPRF and all. So
okay.
Okay, so they're breeding on that one. Large oak blue is breeding.
But Indian oak blue is not reported in Karnataka, not Western Ghats till now. None of us have been able to report. And it is not sal, one or two forestation. I am talking about Shoria robusta forest, because all the life cycles have been done on Shoria robusta. It has been done in Dehradun, it has been done in Central India. So it is all done in Shoria robusta. In Kana, it is found in abundance. Kana and Amarkantak.
Sorry to disturb.
Tell me.
But then Plumbius has been recorded in Valley School.
No, it has not been reported. No. Any? Did you upload in IFB?
It's there in IFB. Yeah.
Plumbius.
Yes.
In the name of Plumbius.
Yeah.
Oh, that can be there in Bangalore.
That's what I'm telling. It can be there. But whatever has been done, I'll look at the image. You have to be very, very sure whether it is Plumbius or not.
Sure. Okay. Sure.
Because the keys are, if it's a female, it is very difficult.
Yeah.
If it's a male, still we can say it is Plumbius. It has been reported from, I think, in Tamil Nadu, it has been reported. Some places in Andhra Pradesh also. But I don't know whether it will be reported and how soon it will be reported here. And I'll see that, look at that image. I'll keep a note that point for further discussions. Okay. This Indian oak blue, it's quite distinctive. And it is, the spots are very tiny and minute, and very regular spots are there. And it is, it has not been reported yet in Karnataka till now. I don't know whether it will be reported from somewhere in Karnataka in future. God knows. And we have got where Aeropala attracts Indian oak blue is found. It is found in abundance. So if I have seen 20, 30 together in one place. Even I have seen large oak blues about 20, 30 together in one place, but not in central India. Bangalore. Bangalore seen, I have seen 5-6 together in JPRF or 10 together, but not sitting together at one place. Okay, but in central India, I have seen them in loads sitting in one place, one tree only, 20, 30 sitting on one tree. And similarly with Indian oak blue, I have seen in Amarkantak and Kana, hundreds of them. And talking about the other oak blues, this is the aberrant oak blue, which is very distinctive in nature. The aberrant oak blue at the top. And we have got our oak blue, which looks very similar to Indian oak blue, which is called the that rosy oak blue. The rosy oak blue, which looks very similar to your Indian oak blue, but it is a typical Western Ghats species in the plains and the lower elevations of Western Ghats it is found. It is another species which is put in the Schedule 1 of the Indian Wildlife Act 1972. This Kanara rosy oak blue and the Tamil oak blue, which is found distributed all across Karnataka and Kerala and even in Maharashtra. This is all these oak blues, three oak blues are very distinctive in nature and easily you can distinguish them from one another. We don't need to have an ID key for them, because by looking at the images and memorizing the image, you can easily distinguish between all the three. Because since Indian oak blue is not there, other oak blues will be, if you find them in the Western Ghats somewhere, Mudpuddling, it could be rosy oak blue also. Okay. And the third oak blue, which is the Western Sentinel oak blue, or the Tamil Sentinel oak blue, here you see the white spots are very prominent, and which makes it different from your large oak blue. The bands and spots are quite different. You see the white spots are not that prominent here, but in Tamil oak blue, Sentinel oak blue, it is very prominent white spots are there, which makes it very, very unique. And it is also very commonly found in Western Ghats. Pretty common. Very common. You go to the low elevations of Western Ghats, it is one of the very common butterflies there. Okay. So I'll not go beyond. Any questions on oak blues? There are six oak blues found in peninsula India. Six. Nothing more. Of course, there is a report of titlers oak blue from Orissa, but still it's in the kind of, Orissa is a different kind of Orissa and Chhattisgarh. So titlers oak blue from Chhattisgarh will be an addition to, when it is basically when it is described properly. We have only photographs from there. Royals. Of course, I'm not talking about all the royals, because in Western Ghats, we have got quite a few royals. But the most confusing ones are these three, and the peacock royal, the plains blue royal, and the tufted white royal, white tufted royal. Okay. The distinguishing feature between the three. First of all, look at the eyes. You don't have to go anywhere. Peacock royal, black eyes. The plains blue royal, gray eyes. And the tufted white royal, black eyes, the brown eyes. The main distinguishing feature, black, gray, and brown. If you see the eyes black, gray, and brown, you call them as peacock royal. And you see the tails. All the royals have how many tails? Two pairs of tails. That is four tails. Flashes have one pair of tails. Royals have two pairs of tails. Okay. And I think I have forgot to mention about one more oak blue, which is found in Western Ghats. That many-tailed oak blue. Hello. Yes. That many-tailed oak blue I have missed here. Sorry. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. Seventh oak blue is the many-tailed oak blue. I missed it. But it is very distinctive oak blue that tails are more in number. That's why I call it many-tailed oak blue. You can easily find them in the lower elevations of Western Ghats. And I come to royals here. The first is eyes. The black, gray, and the brown eyes. Second difference is peacock royal is much whiter in color, bluish white in color, and it is found very commonly in Bangalore. And the plains blue royal, which breeds along with the peacock royal, it is smaller in size, dullish white in dullish palish cream creamish white. It is not pure that is bluish white as the case of peacock royal, and is smaller in size, about 15 to 20% smaller in size than the peacock royal. Peacock royal is always bigger. And tufted white royal, which is not found in the city limits, it is found. It has been reported from Makla, that is that your Horigina Betta and outskirts of Benargatta, the outskirts of Bangalore, because the host plant is different. It is not the parasitic plant which is found inside Bangalore. And you see that crown of Tajuria Jihana. Here you see that there is a blue spot is there. There are blue spots here. If I could enlarge it. There are blue spots are there. A bunch of blue spots, and which is not available in the case of tufted white royal. And the crown of the black spot, the hind wing is very prominent. It is very, very elongated, very prominent, which is not the case with the crown here in the plains blue royal. Because we may distinguish, okay, they look similar, but they don't look similar. You can see the colors are quite different. One is pure white in color, because it is called tufted white, so it is white in color. And it is plains blue royal is having a dullish white color and more muddy in nature, and it is smaller in size, and the tufted white royal is much bigger in size. And of course, the males of the species, they look different. They look different, and you see the difference in the butterfly males also. The figures are given to you, and the bands and patches are quite different. In the peacock royal, the hindwing doesn't have a marginal black band, whereas tufted white royal has a marginal black band. That is the difference between the tufted white royal male and the plain that peacock royal male. And the female, that male of plains blue royal is also quite different. You can see that it is that black, the margin on the black band on the forewing is quite restricted, a small band, whereas the bands in peacock royal and the plains, that the white tufted royal is much more larger in size. Apart from there, South India has got a few more royals, the broad-tailed royal, the branded royal, the spotted royal, and the banded royal. So these are the royals which are very elusive in nature, and not commonly found in your locality, vicinity. And the photographs are very distinctive. You can easily see them once and you'll remember it forever. So I'll not, because I'm here to distinguish between common species, that's why I'm not taking those royals into consideration. What has happened, you know, in Periyar, during a survey, they have photographed butterflies and put one butterfly as common pero. One of the photographs was put as common pero. And later on, when we saw the photograph, it came out to be spotted royal. So be careful when you go to the mid elevations of Western Ghats. And if you see a corn pero, it could be a spotted royal also. So be careful about that. Okay. Don't because why they were confused? Because the tail was torn. There was a torn tail issue. Because of the torn tail, they put it as a corn pero. It was a spotted royal. This kind of confusions can take place. Okay, lastly, the distinction between the male and female of purple leaf blue. You can see the difference. It is quite obvious, the difference between the male and female purple leaf blue, where the male is having this band, this discal band, which ranges from the apex to the base of the wing. And it is kind of diffuse kind of band. One side it is prominent, one side it is diffused. In female, it is a narrow band, which again starts from the apex and also the base. It is a very prominent band. And of course, the open wing has differences that I will not consider here. With this, I come to the end of this particular session on blues. I'll take some questions from you and then we'll sign off. Questions from your side, please. I'm closing this screen sharing and coming back to
sir. Sebi here.
Hello,
I have a question.
Tell me,
sir, is Lankan large oak blue and Vindhya large oak blue are the same or different?
Large oak blue,
Lankan and Vindhya.
There are subspecies of the two, okay, and it is very difficult to distinguish between the two because of the geographical separation. There may be a subspecies and there may be some features which are more scientific in nature, not known to the common eyes. Okay,
okay sir. So what we have here is Lankan, is that right?
Yeah in our South India we have Lankan large oak blue.
Okay sir, thank you.
Any questions?
Thank you so much for conducting this. Thank you so much for taking the initiative for doing this. It's the best you can do in such a lockdown situation. My question is, you spoke about the lime blues. There's another lime blue which is found in Bangalore, though very rarely, dingy lime blue.
Dingy lime blue, okay. If you want me to show it to... Yeah. Okay, dingy lime blue. Thank you for finding out. Again, I am going to show you directly. I'll go to Indian Foundation Butterfly website. And I will show you the dingy lime blue. And of course, there were some questions about some other lime blues also. Something else also there, na? Okay, let me just go to the dingy lime blue page and then I'll share the screen and make it difference. Okay, dingy lime blue. Okay, and I'll share the screen once again. Okay. Now, can you see this page, dingy lime blue page? See the dingy lime blue. The main difference is it doesn't have a tail and it has got two spots at the base, two separated spots at the base of the wing.
And you're not seeing the screen, sir.
Okay. Sorry. Okay. Now, can you see the screen here? The dingy lime blue, you can see that there are that there is tailless. It looks like a tailless lime blue.
Now we can see.
You can see, yeah. In the dingy lime blue, there are spots here. The two spots are not having any crown on them, and these two spots are not present in any lime blues. Very distinctive two spots are very small spots, no yellow crowns on them. That's how we differentiate between dingy lime blue and tailless lime blue. Mainly the difference is between dingy lime blue and tailless blue. In tailless lime blue, the first spot is much larger and it's having orange crown, which is missing in dingy lime blue. This is also found in near Bangalore. Okay. One more question was there. I think I talked about telling you something from IAB. Dull bubble blue.
Plumbia silver line.
Achha, okay, Plumbia silver line. Plumbia silver line. See that this is a female. Why they consider it a female, even I don't know. They must have the specimen with them. They say that this particular orange crown in the tail should be small in the base. I have no idea. I'm not sure. And they say that.
You are looking at the Honey Valley image. You scroll down.
Honey Valley. This is Honey Valley image because there are confirmed reports of Plumbia silver line for Honey Valley because specimens officially have been collected from there. Okay.
There's one from Valley School.
Valley School. I'll come to that. And second is this having this the bluish tinge in the particular base of the wing, which makes it a Plumbia silver line. Similar to all the species. See, there is no difference in the hind wing. No difference. Valley School.
Sir, the media code is CF307.
307.
Yeah.
Last one, I guess.
CF.
No.
Okay.
Somewhere in between. 307.
Yeah.
CM 307.
Yeah, that one. The Kishore Raj T.
It is somewhere Oh, Savita Bharti from Pashchim Banga.
307.
I'm scrolling down. Scrolling up. 307 is still eluding me. So, I don't know. I have doubts. I'm not sure about this image. Hanish, are you sure about this image? Hanish?
It is not showing up. Only close wing.
No, close wing.
So 306 is also there.
306 is also there.
Yeah, so, no, actually in the common also we are seeing such zones in Bangalore. So I can't say.
Yeah, even that's why I say that now. Whatever we have seen is not confirmed. Somehow it has been put under plumber silver line. I'll put a word to Krishnamik Kunte and why it has been done, whether specimen has been collected, because this is no way I can tell it as a plumber silver line. No way.
I have some in from Bangalore.
Yeah, most of the silver lines we see are like this only.
Okay. But I have some records from Krishnaguru.
See, it should be like this. This makes it a confirmed case of Plumbier silver line. This
so that image looks more like a volcanus.
That image, this one or this one? Bottom one.
The bottom one.
Yeah, that's what I'm telling. Nah, it looks like volcanus, but somehow it doesn't put as Plumbier. I don't know, because these are confirmed. You see, Plumbier's silver line is a distinctive silver line with blue sheen and blue patches on the hind wing. That makes it that Plumbier silver line. I don't know. Even see this one. This is having more prominent blue spots by Gaurav.
Yeah.
So I don't know whether this is Plumbier or not. God knows. Okay. Any more questions?
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Tell me.
It's Nagraj, sir. Thank you very much, sir. It's very good.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So, we will try to, collecting back surely and shortly. Let me go back to my screen because my Facebook is visible. Okay. Where is that? Okay.
Thank you, Ashok. Stopping bye-bye.
Thank you, Ashok.
Session, and hopefully, we'll have a session. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, all of you. And please stay safe and do your balcony butterflying. Do your balcony butterflying.
I think you should lead the team to Mysore someday.
Yeah, Ron, we'll do that someday. Someday we'll do that. I don't know when. I am stuck in a oasis called Kendri Vidyalaya Jalali, where I can find a lot of butterflies. Okay. that is good.
Maybe we should come there someday, sir.
Yeah, I'll show you something which I'm having at present with me. I am having with me a small, can you see the egg there? This is the egg of a double-banded crow. Hopefully, it will hatch. There is the egg of a double-banded crow. I cannot show it here.
All the best, sir.
Thank you. I was waiting for it to hatch. Whether it will hatch or it has hatched, I don't know. It probably has hatched.
Sir, there is a demand for a quiz based on today's lesson.
A quiz? Okay.
Not today. Maybe next week. Based on today's learning, whatever we learn today, a quiz session.
Sure.
Time to revise.
Sure.
Class is over now. You want a test also?